The first gentleman is 71 years of age. He's a retired engineer. He presented with a PSA of 11 in 2011. He previously had a TURP in 2004 with an excellent outcome. Clinically benign feeling prostate, fit and healthy. He had a total colectomy in 2004 for ulcerative colitis with an end colostomy. He found that intolerable, so he had that reversed to an ileoanal pouch in 2010 at the age of 70 and did very well. He had biopsies for his raised PSA transrectally across the pouch and was found to have multifocal Gleason 3+3 in 5 out of 6 cores on the left and 1 out of 6 cores on the right. His MRI was reported as showing possible seminal vesicle involvement. But when we reviewed it, we thought there was the TURP cavity. We thought the seminal vesicles were atrophic. There were non-specific fibrotic changes in the pelvis, and there was a lymph node that was probably related to the pouch. So what options are we going to offer him? Laurie, what are you going to offer this gentleman?
Surveillance.
Yeah, why not? So he's 70 years of age. It's Gleason 3+3. He doesn't like the idea of surveillance, though. You know, this guy, you know, he'd rather live on his feet than die on his knees. You know, his parents are still going. You know, he's going to be there when he's 1995. He's not entirely accepting of that. But
can I just make one comment? That is so susceptible to the right information and the right message.
Agreed.
So the guys who don't accept it usually don't accept because somehow they have been misinformed. And it doesn't take long to convince them otherwise. You use words which I happen to believe, like pseudo cancer, and that you know the majority of men have what you have, who are your age, and they get the message pretty quickly. So, a patient preference when it comes to say, having a cystectomy ileal conduit is a different story because that's a real impact. But not wanting surveillance usually, in my experience, is a patient who has some misconception.
Well, I convinced him that surveillance was the best option. And the and then as part of that, because he had quite high volume disease and a PSA of 11, we did some, he chose surgery, but we convinced him to have surveillance. I did some transperineal biopsies that confirmed the high volume multifocal Gleason 3+3, but he also had Gleason 3+4 reported at 30% and 40% of biopsies in the right mid-zone and the base. Stephen. Tim, you put your hand up. Can we have a microphone?
So you've done a transperineal biopsy in order to make a judgment about whether surveillance was safe?
Well, the patient wanted to know, but yes.
Is that what the panel would also do before making... The initial biopsy was on a truss, was it?
Yes.
So you've put a TP biopsy in there as a means of selecting patients for surveillance. Is that what you all do on the panel? Well, Laurie, do you do that now in Toronto, or...
No.
Have you? You don't. You're happy to put people on surveillance on just the one biopsy?
Well, they get a confirmatory biopsy within a year. The reason, only reason to wait a year is to give them a break, because you know we just don't have the resources in the operating room to give general anesthetic to patients requiring a biopsy as a rule.
I was going to come to you. It's amazing how unforthcoming the Americans and the Canadians are at that answer. And if that's the answer, it's nice to know. But it's amazing how unforthcoming you are about that. But it's nice to know. I mean, it's a huge problem for us too. We've kind of got ourselves caught at it. And I suppose now we've started, we've got to carry on. You haven't started. It is a big resource problem.
I think this guy really needed a template biopsy because your confirmatory biopsy is going to be biopsying through his pouch. I mean, you've done that once, okay, but then to do it again does seem a degree of a risk of that, and I think this would be the ideal case. And certainly any patients in our network who is in active surveillance, if they haven't had a primary template biopsy, then they have one at 3 months. We used to do it at 18 months, and a third of those patients were upstaged or upgraded, and they were a bit disappointed. One minute you said, oh, you've got low-risk cancer, and then 18 months later, you've suddenly got a lot of Gleason 7. We've got a change. We now do it at 3 months, and we still find a third of patients, just as Laurie had said, you know, are upgraded or upstaged, but at least they haven't waited a year, and perhaps in their minds, wasted time before one's actually determined what the disease
is. Do the template biopsies change your thoughts?
On this gentleman, we have treated a patient with brachytherapy who'd had a pouch before. Chris Eden feels he can operate on anyone, so that surgery would be an option for him. I have to say, I'm still quite keen on the idea of active surveillance for this gentleman. I'd want to know what the rest of the comorbidity was like and if he really knew what he was getting into.
Do we have the percent Gleason 4?
Good man. So it's 90% pattern 3. And the, you know, this guy essentially still has Gleason 3 plus 3. But he still wanted surgery. But the deal breaker was, one, it wasn't going to be in my hands because I didn't think I could do it robotically, and I didn't think I had the open skills to take on a difficult radical. And two, I couldn't give him percentages with the thought of the possibility of me damaging his pouch and him ending up with at least a temporary colostomy. And that to him was non-negotiable.
Yeah, so we've done a couple of ilioanal patches with HIFU, and so far they've been well. I would treat him with focal, so I would do an MRI if it wasn't pre-biopsy MRI, and I would wait 3 to 6 months for that suspicious SV to go away. It's probably a biopsy artifact. And then if he does need a repeat biopsy because of a lesion that looks more significant, I would do a targeted biopsy of just that area, and I think we have now... We're now doing local anesthetic transperineal biopsies
of just the
targeted area. Yeah. So I think we're now moving away from that full mapping biopsy, and we can get rid of that transrectal route completely now over the next 5 years.
The next gentleman is 68 years of age. He's a retired builder. Actually, we've only got a few minutes. I was going to basically go through the different forms of radiotherapy that we're going to do, but you covered that so nicely. We're going to move on to the next patient. The next patient is 58 years of age. He's an accountant, Hong Kong Chinese, presented with a PSA of 13 as part of a screening medical in November 2012. He's asymptomatic, no LUTs, bulky right lobe, nothing else, BMI 30, non-insulin-dependent diabetic, hypertensive. MRI scan, 18 cc's, normal. No specific changes on the T2, diffusion and ADC map, normal. So he had a PSA of 13.
Diffusion doesn't look normal.
Well, that is a snapshot. His report is not. I'll go back. It's been reviewed. His TP biopsy, he had high volume Gleason 10. In the right anterior, in the right mid zone. So so it was fed back to the radiologist, who emailed me back saying, well, you know, with hindsight, he could see something, but he was probably thrown because the diffusion scans were entirely normal. So it is a worry. We've got a guy with a PSA of 13, an excellent radiologist, maybe not Claire Allen, but an excellent radiologist who's called it normal. But luckily, we did a biopsy because of his PSA and his age. So his goals were cure, but he was terrified about functional outcome. How are we going to manage this guy? Jason?
What did the biopsy show?
Gleason 10, 5 plus 5, right anterior, yeah, right mid zone.
Okay. So, I mean, I think in this guy, he obviously does need treatment, external beam and longer-term hormone therapy, has level 1 evidence supporting its use. As far as, two questions there are the duration of hormone therapy in general in a patient with Gleason 10 disease. We'd be looking at 2 to 3 years total duration with external beam. I think there's an argument in this young guy to consider pelvic nodal irradiation as well. But in general, that's how we'd be looking to manage the patient. I think there's also a growing experience of doing surgery in high-risk disease that can seem reasonable. But in this guy, you have to be concerned for micrometastatic disease given his level of his Gleason score and his PSA.
So he went for surgery. He was sent to a radiologist. He decided to have surgery. Is there a place for neoadjuvant hormones? He thought he didn't want to wait. You know, it was 6 weeks till he could have his his operation. He wasn't, you know, is there anything we can do meantime? Gleason 10, PSA 13, is it going to do any good?
There's no strong data to support the use of new adjuvant hormones before prostatectomy. Mm-hmm. But just very quickly on the point of the MRI potential discordance in reading, that is a really important point, that as we continue to adopt more and more MRI reading, that it's the expertise by which they are read. And I think that that's a capacity issue that needs to be addressed.
The neoadjuvant question has kind of been put to rest in most people's minds, but in those trials that all showed a decrease in positive margin rate of 50% and no difference in time to PSA progression, the Canadian trial, which was the only one that actually stratified patients according to risk, and most of the patients in those trials, which were done in the 80s, in the 90s, were not enriched for high-risk patients. The high-risk patients in the Canadian neoadjuvant trial actually had a benefit.
For this gentleman,
so that is an unanswered question at the moment. Mm-hmm. In high-risk patients, is there a benefit for neoadjuvant therapy? The answer is we don't know. But the answer is not no, in my opinion.
A big part of it for this gentleman, initially up front, hormones would have been ruinous, I think, at the time. Diabetic, high BMI, functional status, potency, very important to him, and his mood. So he had a radical prostatectomy. He had a unilateral nerve spur, a unilateral wide excision, and he's done very well. So he's now PSA undetectable. He's pad-free. He's impotent. He's a diabetic. He had a nerve spur. He may get lucky. What now? So in England, in the UK, there's the radicals trial. This guy's Gleason 10, T2, margin negative, PSA undetectable. He could go into the adjuvant arm. Any thoughts on that? Would he do anything for this guy? He's just got lucky, isn't he?
Node negative.
He's node negative, PSA undetectable.
Would you all do a node dissection in that patient?
Definitely.
Yeah.
You didn't pick up on the fact that, one thing I wanted to pick up on this guy, we only did a unilateral node dissection on the side of the Gleason 10 because potency was so important. You couldn't do a decent extended lymph node dissection and still claim to be doing a nerve-sparing procedure. You can't do. You can't delve around the branches of the internal iliac artery and not address the sympathetic trunk, the sympathetic plexus, rather. Is that not correct?
Some people say that. I don't think it's true. I mean, it's not like the cavernous nerve sparing. I think the plexus of nerves in that area is much more variable. And I am not aware of evidence from Studer, et cetera, that an extended node dissection compromises erectile function recovery. Some people believe it, but I certainly don't think it's been shown to be the case.
I'm not sure it's been shown to be not the case either.
This guy needs an extended lymph node dissection. He is at high risk for nodal metastasis. We all agree with that. I think everyone acknowledges that some patients with small volume of nodal metastasis are cured by resection. And we know where the nodes are. So I don't see how you can justify anything other than that. And talking about erectile dysfunction is a complete red herring in this case. The guy's a diabetic. And
I agree.
He's not going to, who cares? He's going to die from his disease if you don't cure him. So
he's cured.
So
The next chap's 59 years of age, the other side of the coin, fit and healthy chap, previous history of a carotid artery dissection out of the blue, playing tennis, no risk factors, no problem since 10 years ago. His PSA was 0.87 in 2009, and the GP spotted it was 3.9 in October 2012, prompting the referral. Asymptomatic, no LUTs. His DRE was abnormal on the right. MRI was obviously abnormal, possibly T3A. He had Gleason 9 in the area of abnormality in the right mid zone and right posterior zone.
Yep. Any reason why you put two cores through that lesion that you've just seen? Do we need to have all that pathological information?
I did a separate lesion. I've done a right-sided lesion there for practice, but possibly not. But it might guide the rest of your surgery on the other side of the gland.
I'm not sure who answered that question, but if David Neal's in the room, he will know that that's, is, I think, going to become a bigger issue than we thought because of the risk of seeding, in particularly in the transperineal needle tract. And whilst we just don't think it happens, it actually does happen. And there's been plenty of papers written before 2002 where there has been seeding of prostate cancer, particularly down the transperineal tract, where one could imagine there's longer pathway for the cells to tumble out. There are some in transrectal biopsies as well. But I think it will bring the issue that if we can get a targeted biopsy and it's 5+5 and it's hard or whatever, just how many times do you want to go through that lesion? And I think it will be something that will be coming up for debate and discussion much more in time to come.
He had a bilateral lymph node dissection. He was lymph node negative. He was organ confined, Gleason 8, node negative. He went on to 4 weeks of Clexane for his DVT prophylaxis, which is de rigueur in the UK now.
Is that de rigueur in Canada, for pelvic surgery? We have to do that for all, pretty much all major cancer surgery. Is that the same in Canada?
Not 4 weeks. No, it's, you know, it's post-op until, in most cases, until discharge, which is usually a day or two. Mm.
So he had a pulmonary embolus requiring anticoagulation.
I don't think it's wrong. There is, it is supported by data. I'm aware of that.
Yeah. The 8 weeks, he's got a PSA of 0.19.
It's bad.
It's bad.
I mean, clearly, but he's a young patient. He's otherwise healthy. He clearly has micrometastatic disease. He was organ confined at time of resection. I think that our bias probably would be to try to salvage, though counseling the patient very carefully that there's a high risk of persistent recurrent disease despite that salvage therapy. We're becoming more and more aggressive in our salvage therapy, similar to trials here, looking at extended field radiation in the postoperative setting as well as the addition of hormonal therapy. And I think trial-based care is not inappropriate for this patient and the prior patient, looking at more total androgen blockade, some of the novel agents that are out there as well. So,
difficult guy to counsel, this chap. He's not unreasonably feels that he's got organ confined, high grade, margin negative disease with lymph node negative. That he's got metastatic disease. He's not sure he wants radiation. Or hormone therapy.
I would image him first, though. Yeah. I mean, so
he's been imaged. Imaging's negative.
Yeah.
Well, exactly. Well, that's the next question. I mean, see, here the protocols here would give him prostate bed radiotherapy with or without lymph node radiotherapy, and you can't do one without the other. This guy's most likely to have his PSA failure in the lymph nodes or distance. So, and most of his adverse effects would come from his prostate bed radiotherapy to his trigone. And you can't get that delivered in the UK, and we're not looking at it. But what do you think now? I mean, is this proof that he's a good goer for local salvage therapy? Has he missed the boat, or is this, did this say he's got distant metastatic disease?
No, absolutely. I think the fact that the PSA has risen very slowly over a prolonged period of time is an encouraging feature. I would absolutely offer this young guy with no other potential curative therapy other than salvage radiation, plus minus hormones. I would absolutely do that. One very important principle, though, is that you have to wait until recovery, maximal recovery of continent control. So at eight weeks was not the right time to offer that salvage therapy. It was the right time to start discussing it.
Yeah.
But now that it's 9 months out.
Very good. And I think he's ready to go for it. Thank you very much. We'll cut the cases there.